Every time you die in one reality, you survive in another reality.
This is a very compelling abstraction that might possibly sum up our topic of interest today. It is inspired from the duality of nature as one of the fundamentals of quantum mechanics, where a mere change in a simple action can open up a different reality. It's a hard concept to grasp in and of itself, and rightfully so. When Cooper deviates from his origin timeline by sending information back in time, the subsequent chronology becomes so multifaceted that it forces us to question how paradoxes and alternate timeline really operate in an epistemic context. So what are we missing? In this video, we'll do our best to walk through the bizarre, mind-bending concept of parallel universes in Interstellar. A very important disclaimer before we start this video. It is unknown to scientists whether there is such a thing as a parallel universe. Even the concept of wormholes, which some would argue would be the hypothetical portal to enter an alternate universe, it's also not known to exist. The chances that it exists naturally are exceedingly small. So what we could say is, they're only a theoretical consequence of the laws of physics, as is known today. But it doesn't stop us from unraveling some of the deepest questions about the cosmos and our reality. We could describe the physicist's interpretation about these concepts, and I could tell you what physicists think they know about wormholes, time travel, and parallel universes. In 1988, physicist Igor Novikov stated an astonishing idea about wormholes. If their existence are allowed by the laws of physics, Einstein's relativistic law would permit transforming them into some sort of time machines. But how would that work?
Let's explore that statement in details.
Suppose we have this wormhole system with two different portals. To demonstrate the feasibility of using this wormhole as a time machine, we need the two portals to be carefully positioned at specific locations in the universe. They're arranged such that the time difference between the two places could grow significantly over time. Let's say one stable portal is located somewhere on Earth with person A, while the other end of the wormhole is in orbit around a black hole, and we send person B in there. We can assume both person A and B are the same age while this is happening. So as soon as the wormhole setup is done, we synchronize time between the two portals. Because of the immense gravitational pull near the black hole, time dilation is starting to take effect. For this reason, time for the astronaut at the other end of the wormhole slows down, as seen in the external universe. But time on Earth doesn't slow down, because that is our reference. But seen through the wormhole, the clocks from the two portals run at the same rate. They're still synchronized. Now suppose for our imagination, we unite the two ends of the wormhole again. Of course, because of the immense time dilation between the two spots, we could see that person B is still young, while person A is very old. That is, of course, as seen from the external universe. But here's the shocking thing. When you look inside the two openings of the wormhole, both person A and B are the same age. And there, you'll see that the two clocks are still synchronized, just like the first time when they were set. Something crazy is going on. It's the fact that you would create a time machine. If person B steps inside the wormhole, he would be able to go back in time, to the time when he's still at the same age as person A.
Okay, in this very peculiar scenario, there's a couple of things that we could ask ourselves, like,
would it be possible for person B to time travel back to the past, immediately at the time when both clocks were synchronized? Would person B then meet his other selves in that moment? Do we need an alternate timeline to explain this paradox? Theoretical physicist Joseph Polchinski thought about this situation, which now becomes the Polchinski's paradox. It's basically the billiard ball version of this scenario. Meaning, instead of person B, we have the billiard ball that is sent through one portal of the wormhole. Although the idea of a wormhole and a time machine is obviously very speculative, mathematical models have demonstrated that it is possible for a wormhole of some kind to connect different portions of space. That's, of course, if it's kept open by some form of negative energy. If this is the case, then the arguments in favor of parallel universes are on our side. Because given an infinite universe and infinite time, everything is bound to happen somewhere, at another point in space or time.
Now that we have explored this concept from a physics point of view, let's observe how it plays out in the movie Interstellar.
First, we have the origin timeline, what I would call timeline A. it's simply a timeline where the time-traveled Cooper exists. So in this timeline, we see the upbringing of Cooper as a space pilot. And then, he's engaged in some kind of space mission. It could be that it's the same mission as we see in the movie, or perhaps a totally different one. Because we know that Cooper is a former trained as a pilot, right? Anyhow, my point being, he's on a space mission. And one thing to emphasize here is that he passes the wormhole and then the black hole. He escapes all of those magically, which would then leave him inside the Tesseract. Cooper not only transcends the physical constructs of time, he was also in quote-unquote two places at once.
We got into much more detail on it on our prior video here. Please check it out if you haven't watched it.
So now, inside the Tesseract, he consciously decides to transmit the secret NASA's coordinate to his daughter Merv, to a moment before the space mission even began. But why? And for what reason? Well, this is basically to allow Cooper to embark on that space mission in the first place. There must be some kind of trigger in that series of events, because without the coordinates, Cooper wouldn't be able to locate the NASA's location, which would imply that he wouldn't be the astronaut that we see in the movie. Anyway, as you see in a variety of science fiction films, the very act of sending information back in time, or even forcing a different decision in the past, will dramatically alter the course of events. It appears that this new timeline will deviate from the so-called origin timeline. As a result of this, it produces a whole different chronology that I refer to as Timeline B, a parallel timeline. It is a different parallel possibility that would not otherwise exist if there was no information going backward in time. And then because of this coordinate, the movie tells us that Cooper and Merv go to the NASA secret base. He's then introduced to the mission, eventually he goes to space, and Murphy cries, but she becomes a physicist anyway. But hold on, there's still one more significant event here. Recall that previously inside the Tesseract, not only that Cooper sends the coordinate, he also sends the quantum data to adult Merv. As some of you may have guessed, that's actually Cooper from the origin timeline, or Timeline A. This would then allow Murphy to solve the gravity equation thanks to Cooper A's assistance. But at this point, you might be wondering, what happens to Cooper B in this chronology? My strong view is that in this Timeline B, Cooper dies while descending into the black hole. Here's one of the compelling arguments why I could say that. When Cooper enters the black hole, he was panicking, and his heavy breathing is interrupted by a few gasps. He was passing away. But do you know what happens next? We cut to the shot of his son back on Earth. Keep in mind that Dr. Mann says this line somewhere in the movie.
The last thing you're gonna see before you die, your children.
I've got one more proof that I'll show you later, so stick around and let's unravel the rest of the timeline.
Although Cooper B is dead, can you recall what happens to Cooper A inside the Tesseract? I mean, after he sends the coordinate to young Merv and the quantum data to adult Merv. Well, you guessed it. The Tesseract collapses, and Cooper is suddenly transported to some kind of in-between reality. He makes contact with the spaceship and Dr. Brenn. In our timeline, this is how it looks. This path represents the idea of traveling between the two different realities. Cooper A goes to Timeline B, the timeline where basically not his origin timeline.
Which brings us to my second proof. When Cooper A appears in this new timeline and reunites with Grandma Merv, I feel that there's definitely something very strange in this particular scene. What would that be, if you had to guess?
Well, this is what I'm talking about.
Because my dad promised me.
I find it incredibly weird when one of the characters in the movie speaks in third person, when she has the clear opportunity to refer to him directly. She had the option to say, because you promised me. Grandma Merv may be subconsciously sensing that the Cooper in front of her is not the father from her own timeline. Instead, it's Joseph Cooper from another reality. If you're curious about the concepts of space-time, paradoxes, and causality, I'd recommend you to check brilliant.org. They have a pretty cool course on special relativity, where you could explore in depth the topic of reference frames and observers, space-time and paradoxes, as well as energy dynamics. The courses have been designed to provide an exciting exploration into the mind of the brilliant scientist, Albert Einstein. Starting with insightful thought experiments and some tried and true mechanics, you'll bring together these ideas in order to come up upon the incredible epiphany that time and space are a single entity. It doesn't stop there. With only a click of the link in our description, you'll get access to an incredible array of courses, from advanced physics to applied computer science. Amazingly enough, if you're one of the first 200 people who sign up using that same link, you'll be able to save 20% on Brilliant's annual membership. So let's jump right into this journey and expand our horizons with Brilliant.org.
There are a few perplexing elements when you analyze the timeline of Interstellar in details.
One of them is this account of higher dimensional beings. Who are they? What would their chronology look like? The notion that they are the descendants of human from the future is explicitly stated in the movie. They have advanced as a race to such an extent that it could exist in five dimensions. For them, time is a physical dimension that can be accessed. From our perspective as fellow humans who are held captive by the present, their control for time is intangible. However, it still leaves open the question of how they come to be. Does the fact that Cooper is the one who created this alternate timeline have anything to do with it? Here's my speculation. At the end of the movie, Cooper is seen to reprogram TARS, take control of an advanced ranger, and embark on a new space mission. He takes off for one last time to reunite with Amelia Brand on Edmund's planet. From this point forward, it's very likely that they will be the parents of the new era of mankind. It could be a millennium before that happens, but once it does, time will no longer be an issue. Because if they become fifth-dimensional beings, they could access the time dimension to their liking.
At this point, I'd like to refer back to the question of who put the wormhole and the tesseract.
Isn't that the higher dimensional being, as referred in the movie? Perhaps this particular line from Professor Brand makes a lot of sense in this case.
Something sent you here. They chose you.
This is an aspect of reality that we don't yet understand. A paradox. Because Cooper's action to deviate from the origin timeline would eventually confine him inside a loop. A loop that is going on for time immemorial. Without him, there won't be any higher dimensional being. The very same entities that would then build the wormhole and the tesseract just for him.
I'd like to end this video with a little trivia, just so that I don't leave you feeling confused or melodramatic. Let's take a look at this whole chronology once again.
Now the puzzle is, what would happen if, for some reason, Cooper doesn't go to the Tesseract? What's gonna change in this timeline? You should find the solution to this question to be rather simple.
But in case you're wondering, check out this video right here, where I discuss the consequences of that scenario. I'll see you there.